Hello all, welcome to Get Into IAS, and in today's topic we are going to deal with a lesson called as Protected Area Network. So under Protected Area Network, we are going to deal with protected areas and what is a wildlife sanctuary, green provision, conservation reserve, and then community reserve. These are the two kinds of reserve. And then coastal protected areas, sacred groves of India, and then export, map, biosphere reserve, world network of biosphere reserves, hotspots, cold spots, and then finally world heritage sites. So let's move into the topic. So first one is protected area. What do you think a protected area is? So the national policy for wildlife conservation. The first thing is the national policy for wildlife conservation and the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 had enlisted what is a protected area. And then they were earlier, initially we had 5 national parks and then 60 sanctuaries approximately. But now it has developed into 699. This is also an approximate value, that is 669, nearly 700 protected areas. That is, all these protected areas constitute up to 5% of the land area in India. And then this network, right, the protected areas network, has been developed due to various projects like Project Tiger, Project Elephant, Project Crocodile, and breeding and management. So regarding from all these project networks, this protected area network has been growing. And then we've dealt with what is a protected area. That is, you are enlisting an area and protecting the species inside that area. That is called as protected area. So we've done with protected areas. What is a wildlife sanctuary? So we are going to deal with the wildlife sanctuary, national park, and the difference between the wildlife sanctuary and the national park. So what is a wildlife sanctuary? So according to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, so what? According to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, certain areas have been designated by the state government as the wildlife sanctuaries. So a wildlife sanctuary, if the area is of natural significance, if it has any flora or fauna or geomorphological significances, that area may be designated by the state government according to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 as the wildlife sanctuary. And then next thing, what is a national park? So same thing, according to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, the same state government designates the area which is of natural significance as natural park. So we've done with what is a natural park. But you should know the difference between a wildlife sanctuary and a national park. So what is the difference? So the national park here, right, it will have a greater degree of protection than the sanctuaries. So when you compare a wildlife sanctuary and a national park, this national park will have a greater degree of protection than this wildlife sanctuary. Why? You'll know why it has a greater protection. Because the grazing in the sanctuary is prohibited. The grazing activities, no, it will be prevailing in the sanctuary. But the same grazing, that is the livestock will graze on the grasses, right, that will be prohibited in the national park area. So in the national park area, the grazing is prohibited, whereas in sanctuaries the grazing is allowed. So that's why this national park is given a greater head than the sanctuary. And next thing is, wildlife sanctuary can be created for one species. That is, you can take one species and create a wildlife sanctuary. But you cannot do that for a national park. That is, for one particular species, you cannot create a national park. There should be a variation in species inside the national park. So, for example, the wildlife sanctuary. For example, the Grizzle Wildlife Sanctuary is located in Srivalliputtur, which is generally created for the squirrel. And you cannot do this in a national park because, as already I said, there should be variation inside the national park. So this is the difference between the national park and wildlife sanctuary. And then moving on, I've just denoted about only state government. I didn't tell about the central government. Even central government can designate an area as national park or wildlife sanctuary. So this is the major difference between the national park and wildlife sanctuary. Next thing is the provision for wildlife sanctuaries and national park. So what are the provisions? So protected area by state government. So any area that is protected area is sanctuary or national park. This should be designated by central government or state government. So what and all the state government does to denote that area as a wildlife sanctuary or national park. For example, the state government releases the initial notification. First thing, after the initial notification, the final notification will be released. So what do they do in a initial notification? So in initial notification, the state government declare inside or outside the reserved forest. So we already saw what is a reserved forest. Reserved forest is in situ or ex situ conservation. It is in situ conservation. So inside that, they will designate that area as wildlife or national park, inside or outside the reserved forest. And then if it is of natural significance, flora, faunal significance and all, they will designate that area through initial notification. So after initial notification, what will happen? So after initial notification, the final notification will come. They'll put that initial notification for people to debate on various issues. And then for a period, preferring claims, that is, debate will be going on, and then the state government may declare the limited area. That is, they'll set the boundary for that area and designate it as wildlife sanctuary or national park. So this is the process done by the state government. So what does the central government do? So the central government may also does the same process. That is, the central government may be satisfied with the area of significance. That is, if it is of natural significance, the central government will convince the state government and then it will designate the area as wildlife sanctuary or national park. Now we are going to deal with how do they set boundaries for wildlife sanctuaries and national parks. So how do they set boundaries? For example, if there is a territorial waters, that is, there is a land part over here and you have water over here, for example, a lake or stream running over here, how do they set boundary in that part? So normally the chief naval hydrographer of the central government, that is, from the central government, the chief naval hydrographer will give permission to protect the local fishermen. That is, if they denote this area, that is, this water and this land area together to be a protected area, the entry level will be restricted, and hence the chief naval hydrographer will give instructions accordingly to protect the local fishermen. And then no alteration except National Board for Wildlife. For example, if you want to alter this boundary, there is already an existing boundary, and if you need to alter that boundary, the chief executive for that will be the National Board for Wildlife. They will give permission to alter the boundary. Let's come again. Under the territorial waters, the chief naval hydrographer will give permission, and if you want to alter any boundary, the National Board for Wildlife will give permission. And then the Amendment Act of 1991. So under 1991 amendment, it provided for the inclusion of territorial waters. So previously the protected area should be only denoted in the terrestrial land part of the system. But then the amendment in 1991 brought out the territorial waters into the inclusion. And then what are the settlement of rights? So in case you are going to set up a boundary, people will live over there. So they will claim some rights. For example, the tribal people living in that area will claim some land, food, water and all in that place. So you have to settle the rights for them. For example, the state government can make alternative fuel, fodder and other food products for them. For example, if they are denoting this area to be a protected area, a national park or wildlife sanctuary, if there are tribal people living inside that area, they should evacuate them from that place and they should provide alternative for them for food, fuel and all. So this settlement of rights is done by the state government. and then the state government appoints the collector for this process. So the collector in that place will designate all the alternatives for them, and she is responsible for a land to be included and excluded inside the protected area, keeping in mind all the people living inside that area, because welfare of the state is very, very important. And then the next topic is entry into the protected area. So who and all can enter into the protected area? For example, who and all can enter into the wildlife sanctuary and national park? And from whose permission you can get and enter into the protected area? For example, no person other than public servant on duty. So if there is an officer over there and if he is on duty only, he should enter into the protected area. First thing. Second thing is person permitted by chief wildlife warden. If you want to enter into the protected area, you should ask permission from the chief wildlife warden for entering into such area. And then the person who reside in that area, if some person's immovable property, if you are a tribal people and your property is over there, you can enter into that protected area. And then person passing along the highway, that is if you are passing along the highway, if there is a highway present on the protected area, so you can enter into that area without permission. These are the points to be remembered under who and all can enter into the protected area. And then grant for permit for entry. So in case if you want to enter inside the protected area, from whom can you get permission? So the chief wildlife warden, already we saw about the chief wildlife warden, the person permitted by chief wildlife warden. So you should get permission from him to enter into the protected area. And then for what and all you can enter is for investigation purpose or study of wildlife inside that area, for photography and for tourism. So keeping all these key points in mind, you can get permission from the chief wildlife warden and enter into the protected area. And then next, moving into the community reserves. So we've done with what is a protected area, that is a national park and wildlife sanctuary. And then we've saw the difference between the wildlife sanctuary and national park. We saw the general provisions inside the protected area. And now we are going to move to the conservation reserve and community reserve. There are two kinds of reserve. One is the conservation reserve and another one is the community reserve. So now let's move into the conservation reserve. What is a conservation reserve? So accordingly, so long we saw about what is a protected area. So under a protected area, we saw about the wildlife sanctuary and national parks. Now we are going to deal with a new term called as the conservation reserve. So accordingly, the Amendment Act of 2003 brought out a new term inside the protected area list called as the conservation reserve. So long we dealt that under a protected area, wildlife sanctuaries and national parks are listed. Now there is a new term called as the conservation reserve, which was brought in the Amendment Act of 2003. And then this area, that is if there is a wildlife sanctuary or national park over here, adjacent to this area will be the conservation reserve. So this is to protect the landscape in this area. So that point is explained here. And then by whom is this conservation reserve managed? It is managed by the Conservation Reserve Management Committee. So this committee manages all the conservation reserves. And then which one is the first conservation reserve in India? It is the Tirupudai Marudur, which is located at Tirunelveli in Tamil Nadu, is the first conservation reserve. Accordingly, the village people over here, and there is an adjacent bird nesting area. So this whole area is designated as a conservation reserve accordingly. So we have dealt with the conservation reserve. Now let's move into the community reserve. The next kind of protected area is the community reserve. So we've done with conservation reserve. Let's move into community reserve. So what is the community reserve? It is as same as the conservation reserve. So under community reserve, it was brought in the Amendment Act of 2003. So this is also enlisted under the protected area list. And then it is regulated by the Community Reserve Management Committee, same as the Conservation Reserve Management Committee. And then what is a community reserve is the community area of the individuals or the private land. will be used for the community reserve. So this is called as a community reserve. And then moving into the coastal protected area. So the next topic is coastal protected area. What is a coastal protected area or marine protected area? So under a marine protected area, any area of tidal or intertidal or subtidal zone. So that area which is overlaying with the water in the terrestrial land is called as the marine protected area. And then the marine protected area is small in India. For example, the corals, the mangroves, the pond system, all are very small in India. And then the marine protected area is categorized into three, that is category 1, category 2, category 3A and category 3B. So what is the category 1 area? So the category 1 area will include the national park and the wildlife sanctuary which comes inside the marine area. And then under the category 2, it will be the islands which the major part will be subjected into the water and some will be under the terrestrial. That is, if there is an island here, this island's major part will be with the water and some will be under the land. So this will come under the category 2. And then under the category 3A, it will be the sandy beaches. So sandy beaches and all will come under category 3A. And then category 3B will be the evergreen and the semi-evergreen island or forest area. So this is called as the categories under the coastal protected area or the marine protected areas. And then how much marine protected areas are there in India right now? Is there are totally 33 marine protected areas comprising of the national park and the wildlife sanctuaries. So totally there are 33, but it is enlisted as 31. Why? Because that is a marine national park and the marine sanctuary in the Gulf of Kutch area is considered as one. And then the Baitarkanika National Park and the sanctuary is considered as one. That is, the national park and the sanctuary is clubbed together in Baitarkanika and the national park and the sanctuary is clubbed together in the Gulf of Kutch region. So totally you may cut two regions and bring it to 31. So this is the marine protected areas in India. And then coming on to the protected area under marine protection area. So there are less than 4.01% of protected area inside the marine protected areas. And then we've done with the coastal protected areas. Now let's move into the sacred groves of India. So from this term, you will very well understand what is a sacred grove. For example, if you have a tree over here, this tree will be protected sacred by the community, that is mostly by the tribal people living in that area. So this is called as a sacred grove. And then what is a sacred grove definition is, that is, if the patch of forest, it may be huge as a forest or a single tree, that will be dedicated to the local folk people living in that area and the government involvement will be very, very less. And then it is protected by the local communities living inside that area and it is of religious beliefs. Due to the religious beliefs, they protect that forest or tree in that specific area. And then it may be of dry fruits, leaves or anything. Some people, right, in India, they will consider even the dry fruits which is fallen out from the tree as sacred and they will never touch. But in some parts of India, they will use the dry fruits and leaf after falling out from the trees. For example, some dry fruits are not touched, but in the Khasi and the Garo hills in the northeastern part of India, they won't touch the dry fruits. And another example for that is the Gons of the Central India, that is the tribal people called as Gons of the Central India. They use the fallen out leaves and fruits from the tree for other purposes, but they will never cut the trees. So there are two kinds of people who protect the sacred groves. That is, some people will never touch even the fallen out leaves or fruits from the trees, and some people will use that for some other purposes. So these are the two categories inside the sacred groves. And then coming out to the classification of the sacred groves, there are three types of classification. First one is the traditional classification, next one is the temple classification, and the third one is the burial groves. So under a traditional classification, it will be normally enlisted like this. That is, due to traditional values and cultures, if there is a festival going in and around the area, they will use the sacred grove as the center of attraction. And then there will be a groove around the temple. So that is called as temple grooves or temple classification. And then the third thing is the burial grooves. That if there is a burial field over there and surrounding the burial field, there will be grooves. And all these will be considered very sacred by the people living in and out the area. And then next, moving into the significance. So what are the significance of the sacred grooves? First thing is it's conservation of biodiversity. These people take in the endemic species living inside that area, and then the plants or animals living in that area will be valued very much, and hence there will be no biodiversity loss inside that area. And then coming to the recharge of aquifers, so always the sacred grooves will be accompanied by some pond or lake system. So that water will be sacred, and hence no pollution will be carried out in that area. And the last thing is soil conservation. Same thing like that, the soil over there will be conserved to a huge extent. There will be no exploitation of the soil. So these are the significance of the sacred grooves. And then what are the distribution of sacred grooves? So normally the tribal people are found all over in India. So sacred grooves will be found roughly all over India, but to a huge extent it is found on the Western Ghats, Kerala and Karnataka to a larger extent. So coming to the distribution, it is found all over in India, but in the Western Ghats, Kerala and Karnataka, it is to a huger extent. So we've done with sacred grooves of India.